Thank you. Thank you. I hope you can hear me. I will not turn on the video given the bandwidth in certain places. I'm at Easy currently with cable and Wi-Fi, so I hope the connection will not break down. I hope everybody had a positive start into the day and no more emergencies. So I will talk basically, not much new since last time, about cumulance and spreadability. This time I will focus on where it comes from and at the end give some remarks what the higher structures are that arise in this connection. So it's about the combinatorial approach to probability. Which means the moment method. That is, if you have a random variable X and the distribution is just a collection of moments. Moments, a man of X is expectation of the powers of X. And in that, in this sense, independence means that just an algebraic condition that the expectation of f of x times g of y, so x and y are independent, if this factorizes for any function f and any function y, any function g of y. Okay, and then of course by the binomial theorem, the moments of the sum is just sum over n over k, mk of x, mn minus k of y, k from 0 to n. It's just a formula to compute the moments. And if you look at this as a formal group law, forgetting about positive definiteness, it's just a rule to compute with sequences of moments, a formal rule. You can look at its okay, now where do I in the page? You can look at this Lie algebra. And in that case, it's easy, I mean, to linearize this group operation. It's just given by the exponential function, at least by the Laplace Fourier transform. Because by the very multiplicativity of the expectation, this factorizes ety, and this means that if we look at the Fourier transform, the logarithm of the formal Fourier transform, which is a logarithm of formal power series from 0 to infinity mn n factorial tn is again the formal power series, now starting at 1, and the coefficients are called the cumulants, n factorial tn. And then we have that these are called the cumulants, and then we have that this linearizes this convolution. These are just additive. So the nonlinear convolution became a linear operation. So this is the classical case. There's not much more to say because there's only one notion of independence, more or less. It becomes more interesting when we go to the non-commutative setting. A non-commutative probability space is an algebra, A with unit, and a linear functional, so over the complex number, usually sister algebra to have positive definiteness and analytic concepts, But basically, you don't really need this. It's just enough to have an algebraic setting to do the combinatorics. And in the case of sister algebra, the phi is a state that is a positive linear functional. You need a linear functional. And then again, we take X, an element of the algebra, is called a random variable, a non-commutative random variable. And the distribution is again the collection of moments, Mn of X. And now with respect to this new functional, phi X to the power n. So the examples you know are, oops, this was the wrong button. The basic examples you know are, of course, the classical case where you put A equal to L infinity on the probability space, bounded measurable functions, and phi is just the expectation. So this is the commutative example. And then there are physicists among you, of course, quantum mechanics. You notice that X is an observable, self-adjoint operator, and expectation is with respect to some vector state. X, C, X, C. And this is where this the whole notion comes from. We use the same language, so states and so on, a vector state. And then the distribution is the spectral distribution with respect to the state and so on. So this is well known. And something in between the two are, for example, random matrices, where the algebra is, say, random matrices with bounded entries. So matrix valued random variables. And the state is expectation of the normalized trees. It's another example of such a non-commutative probability space. And then we can ask what are the possible notions of independence. And now we have more freedom of choice. There are many, many different notions of independence. Of course, you can have classical, you can model classical independence, which is just tensor independence. So how to construct it? You take U, a new algebra, A tensor A, and phi is phi tensor phi. And then of course, phi is multiplicative. X tensor Y is phi of X times phi of Y. So as before, this means that we can say that X tensor 1 is independent of 1 tensor Y in the classical sense. Also, the algebra A can be not commutative, but it makes sense to speak here about independence. But this is, of course, not really interesting because we have too much commutativity here. A more interesting example is given by Voiculescu's free independence. It's basically the same, you just replace the tensor product by the reduced free product of the algebras. So this is like the free group, but with algebras. The unital free product. And then you can embed, and phi tilde is the free product of the states. Can be different states, but let's take it the same. And then you can embed A in two ways into this free product, first in the first copy and a second embedding in the second copy. And then, so this call it A1, A2. And then if xj are in the first copy, and yj are in the second copy, and phi of xj is zero and phi of yj is zero, then phi of the product x1, y1, x2, y2 is zero as well. This is Boyko-Lescow's condition of free independence in a special case. So this is one possibility. Another possibility is even simpler. This is called Boolean independence, for reasons I'm not going to talk about. Again, you take the free product, but now without unit, non-unital free product. So you don't identify the unit, free product. And again, you embed A in two ways. And now the calculation is much easier. If you take xj in the first copy and yj in the second copy, then phi of x1, y1, x2, y2, and so on, is just multiplicative. Phi of x1, phi of x2, y1, phi of x2, phi of y2, and so on. Okay, in some categorical sense, you can show that these are the only possible notions of independence. If you have very strict conditions like tensor independence, free independence, and Boolean independence, but if you loosen the conditions, there are many more possibilities. Like if you go on QFox space, you have Q independence, but it's not as nice as these two or three notions here. And you have corresponding notions of cumulance, corresponding, there is convolutions and formal group laws and cumulance. Okay, and some time ago, I tried to put this into a common framework. To see what is really needed to have to be able to define cumulants. So the idea is what we have seen in these examples, that x and y are independent if and only if the joint distribution of x and y is the same as the joint distribution of x1, y2, where x1, y1, and x2, y2 are IID copies of x and y. So, for example, in the classical case, x and y. So classical case, x and y in L infinity are independent if and only if the joint distribution of x and y is the same as the joint distribution of x tensor 1 and 1 tensor y in L infinity of the product. You can replace one of the variables by an independent copy, and the joint distribution does not change. And so for the following definition, we just assume that we have such a setting. Assume A phi is a non-commutative probability space, that is an algebra with a unique linear function. And now we don't construct an algebra U, but we assume it's given. Given. So let's do it like this. So an exchangeability system is another non-commutative probability space U. So an algebra with a state phi tilde, together with an infinite family, iota j embeddings of A into U, embeddings j in the natural numbers, which are denoted by x by xj. So these are embeddings such that they preserve the state. So phi is phi tilde composed with iota j for all j. So state preserving. And the second condition is phi tilde is invariant under the action of the symmetric group, so it's exchangeable. That is invariant under the action of the symmetric group, which is given as follows. So phi tilde, if I take x1 in A, I embed it into some by one of these embeddings, x2 by another embedding, xn up to in. This should be invariant under permutation of the upper indices. So x1 sigma of I1, x2 sigma of I2, xn sigma of in, for all sigma in the infinite symmetric group. So let's see one example. So if I take phi tilde of x1, say in the first embedding, x2, 3, x3, 1, x4, 2, x5, 3, and I take a permutation, like for example, 1 maps to 5, 2 maps to 4, 3 maps to 6. And I don't need the other values because the only indices that appear here are 1 to up to 3. So this should be the same as phi tilde of x1, 5, x2, 6, x3, 1, I replace again by 5. X4, 4, X5, 6. That means we can exchange the copies if we do it in a consistent way. So if I replace X1 from the first copy by the fifth copy, I also have to replace X3, which was in the first copy, by the fifth copy, and so on. So the example is that U is the infinite tensor product, and xj is just, you place x into the j's tensor. J's tensor factor. Then these are clearly exchangeable. When you remove these indices under these entries, and phi tilde, of course, must be the infinite tensor product of phi, then this is an example of such exchangeability system. Okay, so this is invariant under this action of the symmetric group, and the orbit of this action in that case is just this partition. So here we have the sequence 1, 3, 1, 2, 3 is mapped to 5, 6, 5, 4, 6, etc. So sigma is constant on these blocks here. So this is a partition. It's a kernel of this sequence, one of this multi-index 1, 3, 1, 2, 3. is a set partition. So this is the orbits of this action. So we call this value phi pi of x1 up to x5. So we choose any pattern of embeddings following this partition. And this is a common value, which I call phi pi. So for example, in the classical case, classical phi pi of x1 up to x5. If we keep this example, is phi of x1 times x3 times phi of x2 times x5 times phi of x4. If you take the tensor example. In the free case, it's not multiplicative. It's more complicated. Okay, so we have now new functionals indexed by pi. And now assume x1, x3, x5 is independent of x2 and x4. In the classical case, what happens to this expectation? We have a further factorization because x2 and x5, these are independent. So in that case, we have a further factorization, x1, x3, phi of x2, phi of x5, times phi of x4. So, which is the same as phi of this partition, x1 up to x5. So what do we have? We have pi equal to this partition. We have partitioned the variables into independent subsets. And the result is this partition, which is exactly pi meet eta. But this is the meet operation in the lattice of set partitions. So in general, P meet eta is the set of all intersections of the blocks, A in pi, B in eta, without the empty blocks. Okay, so this leads to the following definition. If we have an exchangeability system like A, E, U, phi tilde, iota j, an exchangeability system for A phi, then subalgebras A1, A2, in A are called E independent if phi pi of x1 xn is the same as phi pi meet eta x1 up to xn whenever we can partition the xi's can be partitioned into eta ij, partition into blocks such that xi from the first block I in the first algebra and xj from the second block I in the second algebra. We have this kind of factorization, so to speak. It's not really a factorization anymore, but this meet operation appears. Okay, so this works with free independence, tensor independence, Boolean You can define it like this. And it gives the same notion of independence. And now, how do we define components? Again, by this idea of linearization. So we look in some sense at the one parameter group, Volta's. This is Volta's dot operator. N dot x is x1 plus x2. We take independent copies by these embeddings. And we look at phi tilde of n times x1, n times xn. This will be a polynomial in this integer n. And we take the linear coefficient. So this is n times something, which I call the component, xn plus something of n squared. And this is the component. So for this example, the first is trivial. Phi tilde of n times x is phi of the sum of the x's, but x, so the embeddings leave invariant the state, so this just gives n times phi of x. So it's actually a linear polynomial, and so this is k1 of x, it's just phi of x. And what happens later, you see already in the quadratic case, n times x, n times y. It is phi tilde of sum of I, j, xi, yj. And now we distinguish two cases. First is when I is equal to j. We have phi tilde of xi, yi, plus the sum where I is different from j, phi tilde of xi, yj. So the first one is just phi of xy times n. And now we have here n times n minus one combinations of I and j, and we always have the same. Phi, and this is the partition into two atoms of xy. And the linear part is n times phi of xy minus phi of xy plus n squared phi of xy, but I'm not interested in the higher order terms. So this is the second component. Again, in the classical case, and also in the Boolean case, this is simplifies to n times phi of xy minus phi of x, phi of y. So this is the covariance. But already, for example, if you do this with random matrices, it does not factor, the second one does not factorize. Okay, and then when you do the higher order, what pops out is the Möbius function is sum over all partitions, phi pi of x1 up to xn, and this Schützenberger Möbius function on the lattice of z partitions. And in the general case, you can define k pi as sum of sigma smaller than pi, phi sigma Möbius of sigma pi. So this where Möbius inversion arises, and you still have this characterization of independence known from free and classical and so on. Independence is characterized by vanishing of mixed components, kn x1 up to xn vanishes whenever you can partition the variables non-trivially such that xi from the first block are in the first algebra and xij from the second block and the second algebra. Okay, so this is the exchangeable case. And now there is one more notion of independence, at least, which is new and does not fall into this. So another notion of independence was introduced by Muraki. This is so-called monotone independence. Muraki. So the original definition is as follows. We have A1 and A2 subalgebras. And the state has the following phi of x1, y1, x2, y2, and so on. And now in the Boolean case, you had full factorization, but now you just, xj in A1 and yj in A2. So you have 1, 2, 1, 2, this pattern. And now you cut off the peaks and factorize them. So we have the lower level stays, x1, x2, up to xn, and the upper level factorizes y1, phi of y2, phi of yn. So this is not symmetric. This is asymmetric. That means that if x is independent of y, does not imply y is independent of x. So order is important. The order of the algebras plays a role here. So instead of an action of the symmetric group and exchangeability, we only have, so to speak, quasi-exchangeability. And also this has consequences for the convolution, monotone convolution. Denoted like this, is also depends on the order. Mu convolution with mu is not the same as nu convolution with mu, unless this will be important, mu equal to mu, of course. So the problem here is that xy is monotone independent. We can exchange the copies. If you take independent, so there's a monotone free product. And so you can produce such independent copies, but it's not the same as x2, y1. So the corresponding notion is, so to speak, quasi-exchangeable only. Quasi-exchangeable. Or this is called spreadable. You can spread out the indices, but not permute them. So we have to modify the definition. Okay, I'm running out of time. So a spreadability system is defined as before, but same thing as before, but the only thing that changes is invariance. So phi tilde of xi1 up to xin is phi tilde of xh of i1 xh of in for all mappings from n to n, which are not all permutations, but in order preserving maps, order preserving. But otherwise nothing changes. So again, you can now define cumulants. So first we define independence. And this is where now the higher algebraic structures appear. Oops. So A1, A2 in A are called independent with respect to this spreadability system as independent. If phi pi of x1 up to xn is the same as phi pi, now to twiddle eta, x1 up to xn, So instead of the meet operation, we have now ordered set partitions. So we must keep track of the order of the variables. And pine twiddle meet eta is now again the intersections, but in lexicographic order, B1, C2, up to B1, CL. So we intersect with the first block of pi, and then with the second block of pi, etc. And again, at the end, we remove the empty blocks. So pi is B1 up to Bk, an ordered linear set of blocks, a sequence of blocks, and eta is C1 up to Cl, ordered set partitions. And this is known, this is exactly the same as the product in the Solomon-Titz algebra. Okay, then you define Kumonans as before. And you find that Kn of x1 up to xn is a bit more complicated. Now you have to sum all the ordered set partitions. Minus one number of blocks of pi minus one divided by pi. And this we can see reappear the logarithm. Pi pi of x1 up to xn. And now what changes is, of course, now the convolution is not commutative anymore. So the Lie algebra convolution.
Sorry to interrupt, but you have 4 minutes left.
I know. I'm finishing. Thank you. So convolution is not non-commutative. So we can expect that the Lie algebra of the formal group law is also non-commutative. And this you can see when you look at mixed Kumonans. So mixed Kumonans do not vanish. Anymore, and what you get is K1 X1 up to Xn is sum over certain over all set partitions. So when you can eta is a partition of into independent copies, independent subsets. Okay, tau of x1 up to xn g of tau eta. So let me do an example. So K6 of X1, 3, X2, 1, X3, 2, X4, 3, X5, 1, X6, 3. And assume that we can partition into independent subsets 3. Oh, okay, so this is given. So the 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 3. So this is this ordered set partition 2, 5, 3, 1, 4, 6. And then what is, let's put, for example, tau equal to 1, 3, 5, 1, 4, 2. So the underlying set partition is dominated by eta. So this is 1, 4, 6, 2, 5, 3. Now we look at where this this block belongs to. So the first block is subset here. So it's in the third block of eta. Six is again, no. So this is in the third block of eta. Six again is in the third block of eta. Two is in the first block. Five is in the first block and three is in the second block. And now g tau eta is the Kullback coefficient. So g tau eta is the coefficient of x3 squared, x1 squared, x2, in the logarithm of the Hausdorff series ex1, ex2, ex3. So this way you can compute with mixed components. Okay, and in the last 10 seconds, what is the connection now to higher order, to higher order structures? You can realize the Solomon-Titz algebra in the double, in the dual of the quasi-symmetric function, in the dual of the Hopf algebra of non-commutative quasi-symmetric functions, and cumulants then correspond to Euler idempotents. And everything has an interpretation in that connection. Okay, and let me stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your talk. It was very clear. Thank you. I think now I should invite our discussant, Frédéric Patras, on the virtual stage.
Okay, I'll try to share my screen, but I don't see the way to share the screen. Ah, okay. Okay, so can you see the slides and can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So,
So you start whenever you're ready.
Yeah, I'm ready. I'm just trying. Okay, yes. I'm just trying to understand the way I manage the slides. So, I would like to essentially make comments on the presentation by Franz and enlighten maybe three points in the talk. So three ideas I think that are very nice and nicely explained also by the way he tries to understand cumulants in a different way than usually. So these three ideas that I'm going to explain later are this idea that he explained, but I will enter more into the details. This idea that cumulants linearize independence. The second point is something that he mentioned at the end of the talk. There is a very strong connection in general between the combinatorics and the algebraic properties of cumulants and classically calculus.
Eric, we cannot hear you anymore. I think nobody can hear him.
I lost the connection.
Yeah.
Or not?
Sorry, I think.
Frederic, are you here? No.
Ça y est, vous m'entendez à nouveau ou...
Oui, ça y est, on t'a retrouvé, je crois. Oui.
Ben oui, je ne sais pas ce qui se passe. D'habitude, ma connexion est stable ici, mais là, elle a l'air de sauter. Bon, désolé. Est-ce que vous voyez toujours mes slides ou pas?
Pas très bien.
Sorry, I should speak English. Do you see my slides? Can you hear me?
Not yet.
We
can hear you badly.
So you can hear me, but you don't see the slides, or you don't hear me either?
Yeah.
We hear you, but the sound is not so good, and we don't see anything.
Okay, so I will try to
reshare the screen.
Okay. Is this okay again?
Yes, it is.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. Anyway, it's not my, I can do nothing, but for some reason the connection is not reliable. So, and I will conclude by commenting Solomon Tietz, the last, one of the last points Franz featured in his talk. So I will also try to explain why I enjoy very much the ideas that Franz is developing, and why I think it's new and it brings something new in this general context of free calculus, something that I don't really understand, but it's very nice. So I won't explain again the logic of cumulants because they were detailed in the presentations, but the conclusion is that if you look at the classical case, there are two ways to understand cumulants from the algebraic point of view. One is by Möbius inversion in the partition lattice. This is essentially what is underlying the calculus with various families of partitions that was explained in the talk. And as the other way, which is more algebraic, which relies on the use of the logarithmic map to move from the exponential generating series of momenta to the exponential generating series of cumulants. Of course, the two approaches are equivalent, but
ça va être long. I think we lost him again. All right. So it seems that Frédéric cannot make it. So let's skip the discussion part and open the discussion session. So if anyone has a comment or a question, please raise a virtual hand so that I can give you the mic. Oh, there are so many people. So Yannick, please.
Hi. Thank you, Frank, for your nice talk. My question is, can you discuss a little bit about how the coefficient on the Baker-Camper-Hausdorff formula appears in the last formula of cumulant based on set compositions? And just to be sure, did they also appear in the previous formula based just on set partition? I don't think so. I didn't saw this J coefficient, but just to be sure, thanks.
Okay, so let's. So they did not appear in the exchangeable setting. Because it just can't cancel. So in the exchangeable setting, I mean, you can always write the communants as a sum over ordered set partitions, but just you have many cancellations. So in the exchangeable setting, the Goldberg coefficients cancel. And that in that way the mixed communants vanish.
Okay.
So basically what you have is you have like in the Hausdorff series, you have 1/2 minus 1/2. You have like 1/2 1/2 minus 1/2 2/1 and so on. And if you exchangeable, it just cancels. You don't see it. So this is the difference. That's why you don't see it previously. It's a commutative algebra.
Okay, I see.
And they don't appear.
Thanks.
So this is the explanation.
All right. Kourouche?
Yes, thank you for this nice talk. The way to Roman-Cumulant relation, does it extend to the operator valued setting easily?
Yes. You don't have to change anything. It's the same formulas. I never did any multiplications except in the special cases.
I see.
It just stands as it is. Yes.
So you could have all of this stated purely in the operator valued setting.
Yes, it's the same talk.
Okay, thank you.
In some sense, yes.